We have with us Professor David Barstow. He's the Reva and David Logan Distinguished Chair in Investigative Journalism at the University of California, Berkeley Graduate School of Journalism. And he's going to do a little bit of a luncheon keynote to talk about the state of investigative reporting nationally in Georgia. And then we'll come back with this other outstanding panel of investigative journalists. And I'm going to try to put them all on the hot seat a little bit about investigative journalism. Before joining the ranks of academia, David was an investigative journalist himself, working at the Rochester Times Union, the Green Bay Press Gazette, and the St. Petersburg Times. So he got his start really in local journalism. He joined the New York Times in 1999, starting by covering the 2000 presidential election. During his decade there, he won an unprecedented 4 Pulitzer Prizes, either individually or with part of teams. That's the first reporter in the history of the Pulitzers to win 4. That's pretty amazing. Among David's big stories, a probe into how Donald Trump and his family avoided paying $500 million in taxes, an investigation into workplace safety for the New York Times and for Frontline, and one that hit home for me personally at the time. He exposed how the Pentagon had quietly co-opted retired generals to spin for the war effort, even as they worked as on-air analysts for news organizations, including my old one at CNN. So we're going to hear from David for a bit. Then we're going to have that conversation about investigative journalism nationally in Georgia. I'll introduce the other panelists after we hear from David. And for those of you who are student journalists, I want to call your attention to this. There's an opportunity to meet with David, talk to him individually and in a group after the session in the President's boardroom. So please, if you're a student journalist and thinking about a long-term career, particularly in investigative journalism, don't miss out on that opportunity. David.
Thanks. Thanks very much for that introduction. I appreciate it, Richard. I remember trying to get a hold of you when I was doing that story about the Pentagon. I've been thinking a lot lately about Dr. Wen Liang, the ophthalmologist in China, who tried to raise an early alarm in the city of Wuhan about this deadly new plague we all now know as the coronavirus. Instead of being praised or reacting quickly to the emerging facts of this grave threat, he was instead hauled before the police and made to retract his warnings and actually apologize for speaking the truth. And because the Chinese government was intent on spreading nothing to see here lies and feel-good propaganda for several crucial early weeks, we are now facing a global pandemic and a worldwide economic contraction. The current toll is 83,000 infected and nearly 3,000 dead. And among the dead is that brave truth teller, Dr. Wen Liang. To me, and I'm sure to many of you, Dr. Wen Liang is a symbol of something that is becoming blindingly obvious in ever larger swaths of the world. The truth needs reinforcements, urgently, desperately. The idea of truth as the organizing principle of our society is up for grabs. A world built on facts, on measurable realities, on science. A world built on and around truth. That world needs reinforcements. And I'm not simply talking about the lies spewing with increasingly brazen intensity from political leaders across the globe. I'm also talking about the bot armies deployed on Twitter to spread those lies. I'm talking about Facebook saying straight up that it won't lift a finger to stop the spread of lies when they are uttered by political leaders. I'm talking about tens of thousands of truth seekers, otherwise known as journalists, being laid off while the world of spin and strategic communication keeps growing by leaps and bounds. I'm talking about ever more aggressive attempts to demonize and criminalize the act of reporting. I'm talking about rapidly eroding whistleblower protections, rapidly intensifying leak investigations, and rapidly diminished public records laws. I'm talking about news deserts. I'm talking about the willingness of titans like Bernie Madoff and Elizabeth Holmes to make the obliteration of truth a core part of their business models. The truth needs reinforcements. And that, in a nutshell, is why I have devoted my life to investigative reporting. I wanted to do all I possibly could to combat a world organized around lies. I wanted to assert again and again my right to question authority. God invented investigative reporters to scrutinize the dark corners where power is concentrated, where power is abused. I love the dark. And more than that, I cherish how lucky I am to live in a country where me and my fellow lovers of dark corners can still publish hard and unwelcome facts about people in power without fear of being killed or imprisoned or exiled or sued into oblivion. Simply for telling the truth. For years, decades really, I took that right for granted. I just assumed I could do my thing and then come to work the next day and do it again, month after month, year after year. I don't anymore. And that is the most important message that I wanted to deliver today about the state of investigative reporting in our beloved country. We can no longer take for granted our right to do this kind of work. The more political and economic power is organized around perpetuating lies, myths, nonsense, the more power insists that 2 + 2 = 9, the more dangerous it is to tell inconvenient truths and insist that no, 2 + 2 = 4. This basic dynamic has long ruled in places like China and Russia. But the same toxic dynamic is rapidly spreading. Venezuela, Brazil, Hungary, the Philippines, Mexico, Turkey, Egypt, India. My friends and fellow investigative reporters in these places are being hounded and harassed, accused of being enemies of the people, spreading fake news. The truth needs reinforcements. I've been doing this work for a long time. I just began this teaching thing a few months ago. In the course of my 33 years of investigative reporting, I've had a contract taken out on my life. I've been assaulted. I've been threatened at gunpoint. I've had more death threats than I can count. But I can tell you that in the last few years, it has never felt more dangerous to do this kind of work. The venom, the number, the intensity of the threats has increased significantly. It's always an interesting moment for me when people ask me, what do you do for a living? For the longest time, I always felt a certain kind of pride in saying, I'm an investigative reporter. I still feel incredible pride in playing that role. But it feels riskier for me now to actually answer that question to strangers. The truth needs reinforcements. We can no longer take this act of investigative reporting for granted, even in this marvelous place called the United States of America. And with that, let's have a cheerful discussion.